All right, so today we're gonna begin. Today is the fourth. Wow. So we're gonna begin a section on conjugated dienes. And we're gonna actually talk about two reactions. One of them is one of them is going to be the addition of HX to conjugated dienes. And so this reaction is, let me just give it, that's too big. So this is the diene itself, and when we add, let's say, HBr to it, we get two products. We get this product plus this product. We're going to talk about that mechanism. And this is all temperature dependent. Right, so these two products that you see for this addition of HX, the products are temperature dependent and there's a competition, and they both come from a common intermediate. Let me show you that. They come from this intermediate right here. Which is an allylic. Oh, y'all probably sick of that term, carbocation. Right? So both products come from that intermediate. Right? So this particular reaction, we're going to study in detail. We're going to talk about the mechanism. We're going to talk about the reaction rate and the competition between the two products. And one of these products is going to be considered what we call a kinetic. And the other one is the thermodynamic product. All right, so we're gonna that's a topic or a concept that we're gonna discuss when we're doing this reaction. The other reaction that we're gonna study in detail is the Diels-Alder cycloaddition. And with the Diels-Alder, we call this a 4+2 cycloaddition. All right, and it is a reaction between a conjugated diene. So let me show you that here, and then a some type of pi system, two pi system, like a alkene or alkyne, which we call a dienophile. So this is diene. This is dienophile. And when you react them together, you actually get a six-member ring with a pi bond in it. That's why we call it cycloaddition, because you react the diene and the dienophile, and this is the 4-pi system. This is 2-pi. And when we react those together, we get a six-member ring with a pi bond in it. And there are a lot of different facets to this reaction, like how to speed it up, what the transition state looks like, what the mechanism is, all of that. So it's again, it's a 4+2 because this is a 4-pi system. You got 4-pi electrons, and the dying, two power electrons and the dying of power. All right, so these are going to be the two applications of conjugated dyings when I'm talking about and discussing conjugated dyings and what they are. Right, these are going to be the two reactions that we apply that information to. So when we talk about conjugation, let me put this back in the chat for those of you who just tuned in. I'm going to put the handout that we're working from in the chat again. It's uploading now. So when we talk about conjugation, we're talking about especially, and let me not say just conjugation, because there are different I guess I don't want to say levels of conjugation, but something can be conjugated or fully conjugated, and it don't necessarily have to be a diene. It can be a triene or a tetraene or whatever. But right now, we're just talking about conjugated dienes. All right, so that's our focus when we're talking about conjugation in this section. All right, so when we say that something is a conjugated diene, what we're looking at is something like this, where you have two pi bonds that are linked together by a sigma bond, right? And it's because it's two alkenes together, we call it a diene. Di meaning two, ene meaning alkene, right? So there are two alkenes linked together by a sigma bond. All right, so this is going to be basically the focus of this next section. So when we talk about conjugation, the concept of conjugation, right, it's when, again, two pi bonds are connected by a sigma bond, but it does not have to be a diene all the time. It can also be, in this case, a diene, right, where the ion is indicative of the presence of a triple bond, right? But the idea is the same. You have a pi bond, and you have a sigma bond between that pi bond and another pi bond on the other side of it. That has to be the arrangement. It has to be, and I like to just say it in terms of, so pi, sigma, pi. If that arrangement doesn't exist, then it's not conjugated. And this is a lowercase Greek sigma. So pi, sigma, pi, that's the arrangement. So in order for it to be conjugated, you got to have this pi, sigma, pi, or double, single, double, or triple, single, or triple, like so, right? If that's not the arrangement, then it's not conjugated, right? So anytime you have this arrangement, you can say that a molecule is conjugated. And there's a difference in being partially conjugated and being fully conjugated, and we're going to talk about that too. So the conjugated diene that you see here, this is actually would be considered fully conjugated because each pi bond, we could draw that out like this, right? Because there, each pi bond is made up of two unhybridized p orbitals. So this is an example of something that's actually fully conjugated, because there's a p orbital on every carbon. Right, so when you hear that term fully conjugated, that means that there is a p orbital literally on every carbon in that molecule. All right, any questions so far? And it's the same thing with the alkyne. Right, although it's linear, it's the same arrangement. You have a p orbital on every carbon. All right, so the example underneath this is an example of a system that is not conjugated, right? Let's look at the arrangement. So this is what? Pi right here. This is sigma. This is sigma. And this is pi. Does that match?
No.
It doesn't. And so if it doesn't match the pattern of pi, sigma, pi, right, it's not conjugated. Now the sigma bond may come first, but it still has to be the same alternating pattern of pi bonds and sigma bonds. It cannot be like this where you have two sigma bonds separating the two pi bonds. So this is not conjugated, right? And there's a reason for that. Because if you think about the p orbitals here, I'm just going to draw it out. Right, what makes a conjugated system special is the fact that these two orbitals in the middle, if you watched the video, you saw this already, that these two orbitals in the middle can actually overlap, right? And that's good, right? But here, you don't have that luxury, right? You got the p orbital here and the p orbital here, but they're too far apart. Too far apart to overlap. So you can't, you don't get that conjugation here, right? A conjugated system is more stable by default than a non-conjugated system just because of that p orbital overlap. All right. So let's look at some examples down here, and then we're going to talk about the overlap and the molecular orbital diagram, and then we'll probably, we won't get into the reactions today. We're just going to talk about the MO diagrams, and we'll probably stop there. All right, so let's look at the molecules that are here, and it asks which of the following molecules are conjugated, which are not. Explain why not. So let's take the first one, benzene. This is a type of molecule that we call an aromatic. You learned that in part one when you were studying functional groups. Do you think this is conjugated, and how do we tell? Mm-hmm. What are we looking for to determine if conjugation is present?
Two pi bonds linked by a sigma bond.
You're looking for alternating sigma and pi bonds, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're looking for. Do we have that here? If we start here and label this as pi, the next bond next to it is what? Sigma, mm-hmm. Pi, this is sigma. And this is also pi, and that's sigma. Do we have that alternating pattern?
Yes.
So this is conjugated. Aromatics are, that's one of the criteria for aromatic to be considered aromatic, is that it has to be fully conjugated. So benzene is actually fully conjugated because we can put p orbitals everywhere we see a pi bond, we can put two p orbitals. So we can put a p orbital here and here, all the way around this ring. So this is fully conjugated. Because there's a p orbital on every carbon. All right, what about the next molecule? What do you think? If we start here, this is pi, that's sigma, and that's what? Pi. We're not worried about this part, because that would just indicate that it's not fully conjugated, but is there a conjugation present here?
Yes.
Yes.
So is there another name for it, like if it's not fully conjugated or just?
We just call it conjugated. It's either conjugated or fully conjugated.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Good question. All right, let's go to here. What do you think? This is naphthalene, by the way. Y'all too young to remember what mothballs smell like, but I'm not.
No, we're not.
Okay. this used to be the main component in mothballs, but they changed it to some other aromatic. But this is what gives it, well, this plus the menthol is kind of what gives it that minty smell that never goes away, ever. 30 years at grandma's house and it still smells like mothballs. Is this conjugated? What do you think? Can you put the pattern in and find it? The pi sigma pi?
Yes.
All right, you can go here. We can start here, pi, sigma, pi. We can go all the way around this thing. And then this is also that's a sigma bond here. All right, but we can go around it. We can see the pattern that is alternating. All right, so a molecule like this, what do you think? Do you think it's fully conjugated?
Yeah.
It is. All right, if we were to draw out the p orbitals on these carbons, you will see that there's a p orbital on every carbon in this molecule. So it's fully conjugated. Naphthalene is also considered an aromatic. All right, it's actually one of your exceptions because in addition to being fully conjugated, aromatics traditionally have been considered monocyclic, so one ring, but this is an exception. So also an aromatic. That's actually the next section that we're going to cover is aromatics after this. What about this molecule right here? We have a pi bond. What is it missing?
Another pi bond after the sigma bond?
Another pi bond, which is not there. So, right? A single pi bond can't be conjugated. Because when we think about what conjugation means on an orbital level, right, there has to be some overlap of this pi bond with a pi bond that's adjacent to it. And it's not there. Right, so that can't be conjugated. What about here? What's the problem with this one?
There's two sigma bonds in between the pi bonds.
Too much space between your pi bonds. That's exactly right. So this is not conjugated. Even though there are two pi bonds present, they can't touch each other. The goal is to touch and overlap the central orbitals, and you can't do that here. Right? What about here?
Okay.
Say again. You said yes.
Mm-hmm.
Is it fully conjugated?
No.
All right, good. This is an example of a conjugated diene that is not fully conjugated because there are no other pi bonds here. Right? Ooh, I misspelled conjugated. Can't put that on YouTube. Might try to come for me, and I have to give them that smoke right back. That's happened before. Let's go to the next section. I'm gonna put a page in because we need some room to discuss this the molecular orbital theory behind conjugation, right? Because this is MO theory is gonna help us explain the orbital overlap. I'm gonna cut this out. You should have seen a short discussion about MO theory in the video that I sent out on Wednesday. So when you think about, again, when we have a conjugated system, it's the p orbitals that overlap with one another. This is the important part about it. That's why conjugation offers stability. You actually get, because orbital overlap is an energy releasing process, you actually get about 4 kilocalories of stability by a system being conjugated versus it being non-conjugated. Something like that. I think it's like 4.2 kilocalories per mole. Right. So if it's a conjugated system, it brings us to a point where we have to explain that. Like, what is it? What is conjugation? Why is it special? And why does it alter the reactivity? Because conjugated systems react differently from non-conjugated systems. Right. And so there's a reason for that. And we want to start with just a simple, just like you already saw, we're going to start with a simple alkene like this. Right, so the fact that conjugated dienes react differently, we have to explain that. And so the way to explain it is through what's called molecular orbital theory. Right, and MO theory in a nutshell is it rests on this premise that electrons act both as particles and as waves. So the premise behind molecular orbital theory is what we call the particle wave duality of electrons. Right. So that particle wave duality helps us to explain how electrons in pi systems, how they're arranged, right? So it also tells us that the electrons, in a pi system are like a wave confined to a box. So that's how we develop what we call a molecular orbital diagram. Right, the result of these ideas means that we can take any pi system, like a simple alkene like this, which looks like this without the orbitals. Right, and we can develop a molecular orbital diagram for it. So because there are 2 p orbitals, right? Everybody agree that these are both p orbitals. These are 2 p atomic orbitals. Right? That means that these orbitals can combine 2 different ways. So you're going to generate from this 2 molecular orbitals. All right. So if you start with 2 atomic orbitals, you're going to generate two molecular orbitals. Right? The sum of the atomic orbitals is going to also be equivalent to the sum of molecular orbitals that are possible. So that's why we get two molecular orbitals. So this is the particle part, right? Because we know that the electrons reside in these orbitals, right? And this is what we would call a 2-pi system, because there are 2-pi electrons. That's one in each one of these orbitals. Right, so for this, the two molecular orbitals, these exist just like if you remember from G-Chem, like the off-bow buildup, like the 1s and 2s and 2p and 3s, these exist in different energy levels. So energy is increasing in this direction. All right, and then we can put our electrons in these orbitals to explain the reactivity of this pi system. So when you took G-Chem, what was the rule for filling up orbitals?
Do you start from the lowest energy level?
Start from the lowest energy level, and you fill everything there before you move to the next energy level. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to put two electrons in here. And none in the top because we only got 2-pi electrons. So they're both going here. Right? And this is what we call the ground state. The only way to get one of those electrons up to that next level is to excite the molecule with some type of radiation, like UV radiation. All right? So now let's think about the wave part, because we said the particle wave duality tells us that the electrons are like trapped in a box. So like a wave trapped in a box. So here in the lowest energy level, what we call the first harmonic, if you took physics or you're taking physics, this is the same concept. When you're dealing with waves, it's the same concept. So the first harmonic, the wave doesn't have a node. It never passes through zero, right? And so what that indicates is that when I shade these orbitals in, that they're going to have the same sign, right? So the sign of the wave doesn't change. Sign of the orbitals don't change. All right, and now let me ask this question. Why am I giving the orbitals, like the lobes on the orbital signs? Like, why does one have to be positive, one have to be negative? What is an orbital, period? What's the definition? Is it real or is it imaginary? Let's start there.
Imaginary?
It's imaginary. It's not real. It's an equation. It's a graph of the equation of the path of an electron. All right? So for a p orbital is going to have two lobes. This is just the shape of it. One of them is going to be on the positive side of the plane. And the other one is going to be on the negative side of the plane. So it can be shading is arbitrary, but traditionally we'll shade the positive side and we'll leave the negative side unshaded. And there is a node right here between these two lobes. And that node says that there can be no electrons there. The electrons either going to be in the top lobe or the bottom lobe. Right? So then here, the signs of the orbital stays the same in the first harmonic. All of it can be 100 orbitals. They won't change signs at that lowest energy level. And then the other part of this wave theory is that as you increase energy, you increase frequency. So up top, the wave is going to come like that, right? It's going to pass through zero one time. What's going to happen to the sign of my orbitals when the wave changes signs?
It change.
It should change with it, right? So this is now going to be shaded. And that's shaded. So it's opposite, right? So this basic premise about particle wave duality, and this is the second harmonic. Let me write that in here. All right, so this particle wave duality and these orbitals and how they're together and overlapping in this pi system, this can be extended to any pi system. It doesn't matter how many p orbitals are present. If it's a conjugated system and those p orbitals all overlap, we can draw an MO diagram for it, right? But let's finish talking about this. So we put the electrons in, we see the lobes, how they're shaded. We see the first harmonic, how the wave passes through. It's symmetrical, right? So it passes right through the middle of these two orbitals. For even number of orbitals, that's not a problem. If it was an odd number, like three orbitals, one of those orbitals would disappear because that node would land right on top of that middle orbit. So then we know now we got one other idea to add to this, and then we can extend this to the 4-pi system, the conjugated system, right? So this orbital right here is considered what we call the HOMO. And then this is the LUMO. HOMO is short for highest occupied molecular orbital. LUMO is lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, right? What that means is very simple. Occupied just means it contains electrons. So the highest energy orbital with electrons in it is that bottom orbital in the first harmonic. The lowest energy orbital for this system that has no electrons is the one above it. So that's why it's the HOMO and the LUMO. The HOMO means that it is occupied with electrons, highest occupied molecular orbital. And then the LUMO means empty, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. So the MO is the molecular orbital. And that, again, the molecular orbital is a result of combining the atomic orbitals, adding them together. And depending on how many orbitals you have, that's going to determine how many molecular orbitals you're able to form. And I'm going to show you the 4-pi system, and then we're going to quit there. And I'll let y'all go. So this is lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, and this is highest occupied molecular orbital. So whatever we do for this 2-pi system, any rules that we make or any concepts that we apply, they apply to all conjugated systems or all pi systems, right? If it's conjugated, that just means we're gonna have more molecular orbital. So let's take the 4-pi system and look at that. So we have a 4-pi system that's conjugated like this. We can also write this like this, showing all the p orbitals. Right? So that's four p orbitals. What that means is that four p orbitals can combine four different waves. So you're going to get four molecular orbitals from this. All right, so we'll just draw them out. All of them are going to have the same number of p orbitals. Got four p atomic orbitals. And that's going to give us four molecular orbitals. So those four p orbitals can combine in four different ways. That's all that means. Now, if we put the waves in, where is the, so in the first harmonic, which is here, if energy is increasing from top to bottom, the first harmonic is not going to change. That wave is still going to be the same. No matter how many orbitals it has to cover in the first harmonic, the wave never passes through zero. So this is the first harmonic. What should the orbitals look like shading wise? Anybody? Will the sign change?
Aren't they all going to be the same sign?
They should all be the same sign, right? So if I shade these, I'm going to shade all of them same way. Hold up. I got to thicken that pen up just a little bit. So all these are going to look the same. All right, and then we move up to here, again, it's gotta be symmetrical. So second harmonic, the wave passes through zero one time. And when we shade those, they're gonna look like this. So this is shaded. And then these two, the sign changes when the wave, the sign of the wave changes, the signs of the orbitals is gonna change, right? How many times is the wave gonna pass through when we go up to the third harmonic?
Twice.
And it's got to be symmetrical. So it's not going to land on top of an orbital. We got to cut it so that it's symmetrical. Only time the wave will ever land on top of an orbital is if it's an odd number of p orbitals. So the wave now is going to come through here like this, boom, here, like that. And then when we shade these in, right? Uh-oh, sorry. That changes, and then we change back here. All right, and then when you go up to the, that's so sloppy. When you go up to the fourth harmonic, what do you think is gonna happen? Something different, right? Every time you move up an energy level, you add to the frequency of the wave, so it passes through zero more times, right? So the wave is going to come like here, one, like that. So it's going to pass through three times, pass through zero three times. And then your orbitals are going to be shaded like that too. So you got to, this is shaded. And it's just going to alternate. All right. The only thing that's left is to put the electrons in, because it's a 4-pi system. Each one of these p orbitals has a electron in it.
You, my love, I think about you when I wake up every morning.
All right. So when I put my electrons in here, I have 4 electrons. So I'm going to put a place for electrons in each one of these. But again, I have to follow Hund's rule. So I'm going to fill this, then I'm going to fill this, and then the other two are going to stay empty. Which one of those is the homo?
The bottom.
The second one or the first one?
Good. Oh, no, the first one.
No, you're right. This is the homo. Right? Notice it's higher in energy than the first orbital. You following?
No. Explain it.
If energy is increasing from bottom to top.
Oh.
Then the one that's above the first harmonic and the second harmonic is higher because it's over the one in the first harmonic. That's the simplest way I can explain it. So you have lowest energy in first harmonic, and then when you move up to the next harmonic, you also increase the energy. So this is the highest, H is for highest, occupied for the electrons that are present molecular orbital. Which one? So by default, which one of these is going to be the LUMO?
The top one, the fourth one.
Is the fourth one the lowest energy empty orbital? If energy is increasing going from bottom to top, it's got to be the one underneath it. Right? The L is for lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, and both of these are empty. So you think about which one is lower in energy, it's the one in the third harmonic.
Question.
Go ahead.
So, like, because I was thinking, well, if the energy is increasing,
right,
going from the first harmonic to the fourth one,
right,
the fourth one would be the highest.
But the what about occupied? Yeah, it's the highest energy orbital, but it's not occupied. It doesn't have any electrons in it. The O in HOMO is occupied, highest occupied molecular orbital. So that means that occupied means it contains electrons. Unoccupied means it's empty.
Oh.
Right. So the highest full orbital is the one in the second harmonic. Because it's got two electrons in. The lowest empty orbital is the one right above it, because there's another empty orbital in the fourth harmonic, but it's higher in energy than the one underneath it.
Okay.
So lowest, the unoccupied means it's empty. So the highest filled orbital, molecular orbital, is the second one. The lowest empty orbital is the third one. Is that making sense?
Yes.
All right. So we're going to stop here. So we'll pick this up after spring break. And we'll just go from there. Y'all go and enjoy your weekend and your week. And whatever show you're watching right now, go enjoy that. And I'll see y'all back after spring break. Y'all be safe.
You too.
All right.
You too.
You too.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.